This is Busted Pencils, fully leaded education talk. Here are your hosts, Dr. Tim Slecker and Dr. Johnny Lupinacci, educated educators talking education.
Oh, welcome back to Busted Pencils. It's Monday. It's the beginning of a week. Nonetheless, it shall be an exciting day and an exciting week, I'm sure. Jess, how are you doing tonight?
I am doing great. I got some regulating in over the weekend, went to the Wisconsin State Fair, had a great time.
Ooh.
How are you doing, Johnny?
Excellent. I mean, I'm doing good. It's, you know, I'm back fully into the classroom. So we're going to talk about that tonight.
Oh, exciting.
I can't be one of the only educated educators out there back to school. And I think that's on the minds of lots of probably our listeners. I'm sure you have a family member or you yourself's gearing up to get back into the classroom, either as a student or as a teacher in some capacity, maybe as a school leader. But it's that time of year. I'm ready to kick it off here. Busted Pencils, fully leaded education talk, educated educators talking education, just on the boards. And I'm Dr. Johnny Lupinacci here. Dr. Tim Slecker is winding up his Midwest tour of in-person interviews and all kinds of great stories on the ground with teachers and some really great legislators and policymakers,
mm-hmm.
Especially up in Michigan, doing some really good work around finding a balance between needing more teachers, addressing the teacher exodus in schools, but also in making it just a more transparent process for school accountability. And we'll get into that when Tim is fully back on, but you know, he's traveling today. So it's Dr. Johnny Lupinacci here with producer Jess.
Hey,
and you listener can give us a call 855-752-4842. If you want to join in the conversation, but we've got a rocker of a week coming up. So I'm going to do a little bit about talking about what's coming up, but also Jess, I want to just chop it up a little bit about, so what's it like? What are we thinking about as educators when we're getting back to it?
Ooh, yeah.
Mid-August, it's coming quick.
Starting to pack those bags, going back to school.
Yeah, literally and figuratively, mm-hmm. That's for sure. Yep. And now it's that time of year where I don't try and avoid the school supply section of every store, but I'm actually, you know, I'm grazing through and I'm looking for deals.
Oh, yeah, now you can get a little excited about, sticky notes,
yeah.
20% off. Okay. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Speaking of excitement,
yeah,
you know what I get really excited about? And it's important because you don't only got to stay hydrated, but you got to stay, you know, drinking the good stuff. And that, for me, comes from Minocqua Brewing Company.
Oh, yeah.
Busted Pencils is sponsored by the Minocqua Brewing Company. They're big-time supporters of public education. And they, man, this always cracks me up, Jess. They even went as far as to sue the state of Wisconsin to end the voucher system. I mean, they don't do anything halfway. No, warriors and defenders of public education and of democracy over there. Minocqua Brewing Company is making Wisconsin great again, one beer at a time. Check out minocquabrewingcompany.com to see where you can buy their progressive beer. And I'll tell you what, Jess, I am a little bit of almost a Luddite when it comes to social media.
Oh, yeah,
but, you know,
me
too. I click on it and I look at it and I try and stay up with it.
You lose a couple brain cells.
yeah. But I'll tell you what I do love. I do love to look at the Minocqua Brewing Company social media stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Because I love seeing their hope billboards. I love seeing the selfies folks are taking out there of their group of people themselves and their friends attending rallies. And I just love the hope logo that Minocqua Brewing Company has out there with Kamala Harris.
And that hope beer. That's a good beer.
It is. It's good stuff. So anyways, check them out. Minocqua Brewing Company. We love them. They're sponsors for Busted Pencils. But just back to it. So we're talking about back to school.
Sure are.
And, you know, when I started, we talked a little bit about this last week. And, of course, we had our theme, mm-hmm, 20 mm-hmm. lessons from the 20th century, based on Timothy Snyder's On Tyranny.
There we go.
Jess, my producer, and you listeners know. Dr. Johnny Lupinacci struggles with pronouncing tyranny. I have to remember tear, like a teardrop from my eye over that extreme authoritarianism that's possible under tyranny.
Mm-hmm.
Not to say tyranny. That's how there are tyrants.
Yes, a tyrant.
Practice tyranny.
There we go.
That's a little lesson today that I struggle with, but I got a great tip from Jess today. Remember, tear, like cry, like a tear from your eye over the possibility of losing democracy to tyranny. Well, we won't. Why won't we? It's because, one, we're learning all the time how to resist it, how to defend democracy. But two, because we have energy to exercise our civic duty and do that kind of work. So we had the 20 lessons from the 20th century last week themed, you know, believe in the truth. We're going to come back to that because I think this is an important thing this week, focusing on truth, talking a little bit about misinformation versus disinformation, but also just the shift, the turn in the tide.
Mm-hmm.
I finished my school year working with a lot of teachers, and I'm going to be honest, with a lot of anxiety around return to school in the fall with the election coming and all of the kind of political rhetoric that was stewing and brewing.
Yeah.
Right around the end of the school year. And you know, a lot of us educators, we had to do a little bit of like just some self-care, some check around. Okay, let's not start spiraling or letting the avalanche of anxiety pile up now. Let's gather information. Let's build solidarity. Let's talk to experts who do this all the time, and let's plan for the fall. And it shifted a bit. I will say there's still lots of planning and there's still some anxiety, but it shifted a bit because it's turned from anxiety of, oh no, what's it going to be like to a little bit more like, okay, we're starting to see what it's going to be like. And it's kind of exciting. It's an exciting moment to be a teacher. So we're going to talk a little bit about that tonight.
Can you believe that it's only been 6 weeks since the attempted assassination?
No, it feels like at some moments, Jess, it feels like 2 days ago, and in other moments, it feels like a year ago.
Yeah.
It's,
like
it's like a year's worth of news.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So I can't, and I also can't believe that. I think it was just last week we were 90 days out to the presidential election. Speaking of that, just since we're given dates and talking elections, Wisconsin's fall primary election is tomorrow, folks.
Mm-hmm.
Tuesday, August 13th. Find out what's on your ballot and where to cast it. You can go to myvote.wi.gov. That's myvote.wi.gov. The polls close at 8 p.m., right, Jess?
Indeed.
And the media, civic media coverage of the results are immediately following that, right, with News Director Terry Bell starting at that same time. So,
oh, yeah.
Boom. Polls closed. Terry Bell, you got it right here. Tune into your favorite civic media station for results from the contested primaries and the two proposed constitutional amendments. Big day tomorrow. Big, big day.
Big day tomorrow. There's quite a few contested races around the state that are very, very interesting. There's going to be a lot of democracy in all the action tomorrow. Please, please, please get out to vote. If you did not register to vote yet, you can register and vote on the same day in Wisconsin. So please do so.
Yep. And it's a good old, like folks listening, you know, I zoom in now. I'm a former Midwesterner and now I'm,
you never lose your status as Midwesterner.
You never lose your status. Well, it just depends on how long you've been there. And if it's like, it's your home. But you know, I spent more of my, I spent birth to well into adulthood, and now I'm displaced, a little bit relocated, not forcibly by choice, over to the Pacific Northwest, inland Pacific Northwest, where I get to, you know, prepare teachers and work as a researcher in education, something I had been building for some time when I was a teacher in Detroit. But nonetheless, why I digress a bit from saying I miss voting in person. I miss going to the polls here in Washington.
It's all by mail, right?
We do all by mail ballot, which also has its benefits and it has some cons. And one of the cons is just the tradition. I miss going to the polls. I love the lines. I love the camaraderie. I love the energy. It's an event. But also, you know, I spent many of my voting years in Michigan before I had a family. Before I, you know, it was always difficult to get off work you know, to get to the polls on time, to deal with long lines. So I don't want to idealize it. In many ways, voting by mail is convenient. But sometimes I wonder, because there's something special about going into the ballot box, about going in there
completely,
even in some of the messiest sort of almost protest-like settings that I voted in, right? You got to go into a room and it was you and the ballot.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, you know, it was an honor. It was a responsibility. It was a duty. And nobody could, like, there's lots of, I guess, tangent ways to influence votes. But you learned early, and I hope more folks know this, that's your right. That's your vote. And so sometimes, Jess, I do worry, it's fun to vote where I can, like, involve my kids mm-hmm. and say this is what, like, to bubble it in and see that. But we share similar politics. You know, I hope that, you know, they have some I'll provide it when they're at voting
age. You can create the ceremony in your home and you can make those rituals. I do love voting day of. My dad always starts badgering me. He's like, did you vote yet? Did you vote yet? And I'm like, no, I like to vote on election day. I like the ceremony of it. I like going in on election day and waiting in the lines and getting my sticker.
The sticker, right?
The sticker.
I know. And they do
most important part, putting it on my forehead and sending a selfie to my parents.
We do get a sticker. It's in your ballot package, and you do all kinds of stuff to seal it. And you, like you said, Jess, yes, you can replicate the ritual in your home, in your neighborhood. But then this is the little bit of the pessimistic side of me. I start to worry that, oh boy, what if you weren't respectful of other people's privacy and their right to vote individually? And as a household, you had kind of, you know, a little bit more of a heavy hand, as we know. The dangers and the ills. I mean, our generation is working really hard to undo this, and I have big hope for future generations. But patriarchy and sort of, you know, ages and that power dynamic is real. And so, you know, I do sometimes gasp and think, man, that is something I do miss about in-person voting. Obviously, pros and cons to all these. But nonetheless, we are promoting that. It's the Wisconsin primary election tomorrow. Get out and vote if you can. If you need a ride, contact somebody. Get out and do it. Hey, this is Busted Pencils, fully leaded education talk here at Civic Media. Stay tuned. We're going to talk more back to school. And we are back. This is Busted Pencils, fully leaded education talk. Educated educators talking education. This is Dr. Johnny Lupinacci with you tonight. It's Monday. We've got an amazing week. Jess, producer, and I were just talking about it, you know, emphasizing, hey, it's a primary tomorrow. That's an action-packed day. I'm going to tease a little bit, too, for folks who are listening and tune in tomorrow. We know you tune in every day, but tune in tomorrow. Special guest, we got a Rethinking Schools episode with educator extraordinaire Ty Marshall. He's going to be on talking transgender justice in schools. An amazing resource for educators. I would even say for parents, policymakers, and leaders, but especially teachers. I know I learn a lot. It came out just this month, already going through it, getting ready for my classroom and talking about back to school. That is definitely one of the resources I'm bringing back to school with me this fall in the classroom is Transgender Justice in Schools, a new publication from Rethinking Schools. Great resource for teachers. And we're going to have educator extraordinaire on tomorrow on the show, Ty Marshall. So stay tuned for that. But Jess, do we have a phone call?
We sure do.
Oh, let's get that phone
line
open.
We got Ellie Tom on the lines.
My
Tom,
guy,
what's up?
How's it-
Hey, Johnny, first off, I want to let you know I didn't miss class on Friday. I actually was at a Foo Fighters concert. and still listen to Busted Pencils. So let them know that some people don't take a skip school at all. So just want to get that out there. I just want to continue to push on the fact of what Coach Harris and Coach Waltz are talking about, you know, which again, I want to try to steer towards policy, you know, which is strengthening unions and retiring with dignity, building wealth for each individual person, paid leave, child care, health care for all, taxing the billionaire class, rent control, woman's right to choose, gun safety, LGBTQ plus rights and inclusion for all, taking on the corporations, taking on big pharma, taking on big landlords, bringing jobs back to America, fight for freedom, John Lewis Voting Rights Act, public education. I mean, these are things that we need to keep on hammering every single day, talking about actual policy.
Absolutely. L.A. Tom, we love the call, man. And we couldn't agree with you more. It is so important to get into contrasting and putting energy and attention towards the policies of Kamala Harris and the policies and the record of support for those important things like housing, like medical care, like retirement, Social Security. I mean, all of those technically fall under the broad term Social Security, you know, but the actual Social Security program, which is so important to aging and to having, you know, our diverse communities supported. And also, while we're talking about that, just supporting diversity in a democracy.
Yeah.
And the ways that the policies of Kamala Harris and the policies and track record of Tim Walz support that. So thanks, L.A. Tom, for reminding us of that. And my guy, I hope you enjoyed the Foo Fighters concert. Love that. I mean, obviously, if listeners aren't familiar, you know, Dave Grohl, I'd call him front man for the Foo Fighters, just an epic band and an epic drummer turned front man, right? Nirvana's drummer turned front man of a legacy of a band, Foo Fighters. But I'll tell you what, one of my favorite things about Dave Grohl is how outspoken he is, a supporter of public education and education. Yes. I mean, his mom's a teacher. He talks about it. You know, this is also like Tom Morello. And there's a whole gang of these folks who just remind us. And I love it because we have whole shows on this and we'll have other shows on it. But especially as we're talking about back to school, the way that Dave Grohl, right, talks about education is a harsh reminder to everyone, both students, teachers, leaders, all the folks who participate as stakeholders in education, that we've got to remember to separate education from schooling. Mm-hmm. Schools do a really good job of sorting out, quote unquote, the educated, you know, from the uneducated. And that's a big myth. What they do often is they send a message to young people that, hey, you're a terrible student. And that because you're not a good student, really, because you're not conforming or you're not fitting to the way schooling is too often done, that you're not intelligent, that you're not smart, that you're not, you know, creatively brilliant in all kinds of ways or worth the time to be treated well and to learn to treat others well. This is a huge failure of school systems around the world, but and our country is also guilty of this. Schooling, you know, sorts kids into types, and it unfortunately benefits a few at the cost of making so many people feel like they're failures, right? Or like they don't belong. In a best case, you end up like someone like Dave Grohl, who experiences school as a terrible student, but he knows better. He's supported in a different way. He knows a creative genius. He knows he's a smart guy, you know, and he pushes through it. But it's really disheartening to know that for so many people who experience school, listener, maybe you out there experienced school in a way where you kind of, if you didn't fit the mold, you know, you kind of got pushed either out or down or left feeling like, I guess I'm just not the smart type or the educated type. And for so many, I'll even say, as far as to all of you, if that was your experience, that's on schools. That's not on you. And that's not saying you don't have responsibility for your education. It's just, that's how powerful schools can be. They can really push people down and out. And so that's a good reminder as we're getting ready for back to school. I'm going to flip it because we do have to go back to school, but back to education, back to day in, day out, what we can do as educators or as students or as people in that process to make schools more about education, right? Less about compliance and more about engagement. Less about fitting in and more about belonging. You shouldn't have to change who you are in order to be successful somewhere, especially like schools. You should be able to belong, not have to fit in. So we're going to get into that a little bit. Like, what does that mean to create a space where people belong and feel welcome rather than where they have to fit in? To have a learning space that's based on engagement and recognizing and valuing students, not on compliance, right? And I love that. So L.A. Tom, when he called tonight, one of the things he shared, Jess, was he said, Coach Kamlon, Coach Walls.
I love that he just calls him Coach Walls and Coach Walls. That was good.
I don't know Kamala's background in terms of coaching.
I don't know that she's been a formal coach.
I think she's probably a good one. I mean, she's got a powerful voice. She seems like she's quite a motivating speaker and she's a good leader. So I'm sure she'd make a good coach. We know Tim Walls is definitely coached. Mm-hmm. I'm biased. I'm a coach. I've always loved coaching. I've always learned a lot from my coaches. So that said, I love that because when you think about coaching, when you think about what counselors do, when you think about that role versus, being a cop in a classroom, compliance versus engagement, right? The kinds of ways we engage and we're present where young people or really any age people are vulnerable and learning. That's an important role. So we're going to get into that. Listeners, stay tuned. If you kind of join the conversation, join us 855-752-4842. This is Busted Pencils. Fully Let It Education Talk. Stay with us. Busted Pencils, Fully Let It Education Talk. Straight out of the cannon tonight. What a break. We are in the second half of the show. We love that you're with us, listener. If you want to join the conversation, 855-752-4842. Jess, I'm fired up. It's Monday. Busted Pencils, Fully Let It Education Talk. The music is fully leaded. We are rocking and rolling here tonight on Busted Pencils. We are talking about back to school. Take that energy. Pile it up, package it, put it in your backpack, put it in your lunchbox, put it in your pencil case, bring it to class with you, right? But that energy we have. And Jess, you asked a question in the chat before the break, and I got onto a whole tangent about music and rock and all this stuff. So if you're in the stream, you got the bonus. We're going to shift gears a little bit back to school. Back to school. That's right. Back to school. And you asked a great question. How do you set up a classroom that supports all of your students? Wow, that's $1 million question. Actually, probably a priceless question. It's going to look different everywhere. And one of the first things we always talk about in education, especially as we're about to head back into the classrooms, because for us educators, there's a little bit of time before the children, or I'll say the students, whatever age they are actually back in our classrooms, but we've already begun our transition into the classroom. And we're preparing sort of the physical learning environment, right? We're setting up a classroom, we're preparing, we're thinking through. And one of the often not talked about aspects of that is the important practice. And Educators Amplify will be on Wednesday. Teacher Joanna and Teacher Hallie teach this and they do it and they model it really well. We'll ask them about it, they'll talk about it. But it's how we do sort of an inventory of ourselves, how we're asking ourselves how we're doing, what are we thinking about, what are the things on our hearts and minds as we're preparing to have our students come into the classroom. That's a really important self-reflective practice that good teachers do. And that's what we're doing right now. If our students aren't back in the classroom yet, really thinking, and that's a warm-up to that question, Jesse said, like, how do you set up a classroom that supports all students? First, you got to be ready for that.
You got to set up yourself first, huh?
Right. You got to set up yourself first. Almost like we talked about last, before we broke for the half hour, we talked about coaches. So my coaches and athletes out there, you know about this. You got to stretch, mm-hmm. right? You got to warm up before you jump into that activity. And it's important to remind, especially the players we coach or the athletes, or maybe you're a leader or you instruct an exercise group, you know you got to stretch out. You got to make sure you're hydrated. You got to make sure that you're warmed up before you put your body through the sort of physical activity that it does. This is very similar. You got to really make sure you're getting into the practice. You're warming up. It sounds silly. Vocalists know about this. You got to warm up your vocal cords. Public speakers know about this. Teachers, we don't often talk about it enough, but we're in our classroom starting to hear our teacher voice. It's summer. I haven't had to use my teacher voice much this summer, right? I haven't had to say out loud. Well, actually I have quite a bit. So, yeah, some of us parents and teachers know about this, but I haven't had to ask like, hey, what are we supposed to be doing right now? Right? Or, hi, I got an idea. Let's talk about and shift and, you know, change. And so we get back into that, into our teacher voice. And I say that, Jess, it sounds silly. I say that because we all have our different words and phrases we use. We all do this differently in the classroom. And one thing that's universal for all of us, every single person out there, if you went to school, you experienced an overwhelming majority of being told what to do, of being spoken to in an authoritative tone, and sometimes a degrading ways. And so we're trying to break those habits, and that's hard to do when you're stressed, and that's hard to do when you rely on that primary socialization, or translate that, the experience that overwhelmingly all of us had. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was mostly yelled at in schools. I'm not here to just say like, woe is me or victim. That's common for a lot of kids with ADHD.
But that's been your experience.
Yeah, and it's not uncommon. And it was actually pretty mild compared to other kids. And that's not every teacher, but it's often enough that if we're not checking ourselves and knowing ourselves and hearing ourselves and rehearsing a bit, saying, hey, welcome to the math party. I mean, that's what I would say in my math classroom all the time. That's my
welcome to the math party.
That's right.
I love that.
That's my lingo. That's my vibe. But I had to practice that and hear myself saying that so that it was authentic, so that it rolled off the tongue. So I said it with confidence, but not authority.
Yeah,
I can model humility.
You want to hype them up. You don't want to scare them.
Yeah, and I also want to be regulated for them. There's one thing, and I taught teenagers and preteens. So I had the toughest audience for this. But middle school students and high school students have impeccable radar for inauthenticity.
Oh, yes. 100%.
Preteens and teens have like impeccable
I got
radar.
Seventh graders. They will stare daggers at me if I try to do anything insincere.
I promise you, if I walk into a classroom in a couple of weeks and I say, if I try and like in a false way, adopt their lingo, right? If I say, this is Sigma, this is
Skibbity.
Skibbity this and that. Right? They're going to just be like, this dude is the fakest old man that ever existed. So you got to be you. But how do you know who you are in an engaging way? This is the time of year we are. We're practicing it in our classroom. Speaking of being you.
There it is.
Just tonight's flying by. But you know what that bell means, listener? Every day here on Busted Pencils, fully leaded education talk, we do democracy in action.
We sure do.
We recognize democracy in action somewhere. This is what today's democracy in action recognition goes out to. Goes out to all those young people with impeccable radar for inauthenticity. We got to tap into that, teachers. We got to foster that because last week we talked about the importance of truth.
Mm-hmm.
And a core democratic value is truth. The government nor citizens should not lie. Like, we shouldn't lie.
We shouldn't.
So don't be honest. Practice honesty, right? And one of the things that we're talking about when we're talking about get ready for school is be you, be real, and practice ways of being that in supportive ways of young people. So today's democracy in action goes to all those young folks who can detect and call out inauthenticity with like, with the snap of a finger. I mean, they feel it.
Yeah. Talk about checking a source. They can tell instantly.
And so this is important because we're talking about it as the theme this week, you know, believe in truth. So a little recap on 20 lessons from the 20th century. Timothy Snyder, from his snappy pamphlet or book, however you want to kind of categorize that publication, on tyranny. The 10th lesson that he shares is believe in truth. He writes, to abandon facts is to abandon freedom. If nothing is true, then no one can criticize power because there is no basis upon which to do so. If nothing is true, then all is a spectacle. The biggest wallet, unfortunately, too often pays for the most blinding lights. So beware the hype. Don't believe the hype, right? And be you. Be real. In order to be you and be real as an educator, you got to do some self-reflecting and some inventory, right? And say, okay, if I'm going to work on a classroom that's a space where all my students will feel like they belong, I can kind of prepare for that. But that means I'm going to be spending a lot of time figuring out who they are.
Yeah.
So we're going to spend a little time as we prepare in our classroom to share how we come together and learn. Now, as the leader of that space, right, I'm thinking especially about our theme, truth and honesty, being myself, knowing myself, and sharing some of those values that I've learned as a professional educator belong in classrooms for all children. Now, that's not me saying I'm going to share my values and my ethics imposed on them. That's saying there are some structures that we know are super helpful to all learners. And what I'm going to suggest for me, those are children's rights.
Mm-hmm.
Like the Universal Declaration has, you know, I won't call them like a subset. It's actually called a Convention on the Right of the Child. It's a set of articles within the human rights, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, that are based in children's rights. And I always review those. Actually, I review them weekly with myself. I check in. I reflect on my teaching. Hey, am I honoring children's rights in what we're doing in class this week, what we're planning on doing, and reflectively on what we've done? This is super important. But I also start every class I teach with learning what those children's rights are, learning what our human rights are, understanding those so that we can say, as we come together to learn in this space, to the fullest extent of the power I have as your teacher, this classroom will honor those rights. And together, we'll work to apply the best information we could get our hands on. And that's including me. And I got a lot of privilege and power when it comes to access to information because I'm grown and I'm a teacher. I also have my beliefs and my views. But we together are going to figure out what our individual beliefs and views are based on the best information I can bring together and how we can be the best citizens and learners we can be in our classroom. And that can be guided by our children's rights, right? And we teach what they are. That's the basis. But then, you know, we talked about this a little earlier. That's like a lesson I would do with students as we ease into the week. So we're going to create our classroom expectations together in a discussion, right? We could do a whole show on that effect. I got some ideas, Jess. We're going to bring guests. And talk
Let's
about how they set classroom expectations as a group.
Very good.
Right? Versus I'm just coming in hot with some rules, right? That's authoritarian. Now, that said, just shockingly, because I've taught this for so long, when students visit my classroom, they say, oh, you do have rules. I say, yeah, of course we have rules. You know, we actually have three rules that I actually have up before we even create our classroom expectations together. And we figure it all out and we draft sort of our classroom constitution and how we do that. And that's all aligned with our children's rights and our human rights. But I do start out of the gate because my job as a teacher is to provide safe, welcoming, learning environment for everyone. We do have three rules, right? Be safe. And how we say we be safe, it's not like be quiet and don't take risks. It's how do we make sure that you and everyone in here has physical and emotional safety? This is big, like rule. I will make sure. And I ask kids, hey, what's physical safety? What do I mean by that? What I mean, like, you should feel safe here. You should not be getting hurt, or like falling down, getting kicked, getting hit, you know, dangerous stuff. Like I might say, hey,
pencils,
you don't run in-
should not be thrown. Yeah.
We don't throw things at each other. You know? Yeah. So they know this rule. We talk about it. Hey, it's a rule. Safety. Yep. Got to be safe.
Yep.
Right? Right? The other one, everybody participates.
There we go.
Everybody participates. Be safe. These are the two. Yep. Okay. We can get into the weeds on them later. We're going to set classroom expectations. But can you do these things? And then I say, here's a secret about my classroom. And this is my flavor. It might not be yours. You don't have to adopt it. But I always add it too. I say, low key, by participation. I mean, as often as we can have fun.
Yeah.
Like, not every moment is fun. Right. Some things are going to be hard. Some things are going to be tough. But overall, as often as we can, going to make sure we feel safe, we are safe. Boom. And that we're participating. And as often as possible, fun.
Yeah.
Because that's important to me. So if it ever gets not fun, the only rule I have for you is that you say, hey, I'm not feeling like I can participate. Mm-hmm. I need a little more fun. And we get into that. Everything else we build together, and we build together based on children's rights, you know, expectations. And you know, we can talk about it more. Those first days when you're doing that, when you're building those relationships, you're learning who your students are. You're really learning. And just, this is very different than I was taught to be a teacher. And if you're listening out there, many of us were taught, don't crack a smile until at least after, you know, Halloween.
Oh my goodness. That sounds awful.
Lay down the law, start with the rules. You know, I was actually told by elder teachers before, you know, you're a male too. You can get away with this. Kick a trash can really hard across the room.
No.
These are kind of like some of the bad habits of schools. We're saying, hey, undo them, break those habits, be your best self. Be ready by knowing yourself. We can get to the details and the rest. Hey, this is Busted Pencils, Fully Leaded Education Talk here on Civic Media. This is Dr. Johnny Lupinacci. Stay tuned. We got an exciting week, and we're going to preview some of that week when we come back. Busted Pencils, Fully Leaded Education Talk. We are back here. Dr. Johnny Lupinacci here with producer Jess.
Hey, yo.
Listener, if you want to join the conversation, give us a call, 855-752-4842. We're talking back to school. We're talking about building a classroom environment students feeling welcomed, of them belonging, of engagement, not compliance. And Jess asked the great question, where do you start? And I give my long-winded version of start with yourself. Be well. Know thyself. And we all do this differently. So when we get into the specifics of like how we have our classroom set up, the voice we use, the phrases that we use, the themes that we have, you know, the ways we connect the dots for our students, hopefully using current events, things they care about, you know, making learning meaningful and relevant to them and their lives. We have to learn their lives. And some of us, we got a little bit of an idea, but I would say don't ever assume we know, and just go in with an openness and a readiness, right? And a confidence. And some of that confidence comes by practicing. So if you're like me and you're back in the classroom, setting things up, putting up posters, kind of decorating, you know, and having conversations like Jess and I are having about the music that we share, not only in the show, but with one another as we work. And I always have music in my classrooms. And that's one way I get to know my students is I ask them, hey, what are you listening to? What gets you pumped? What helps you focus? We do a whole little questionnaire around our favorite places. The first activity I do, Jess, I do in a classroom with all my students is that little questionnaire about what are they listening to? What's something they watched recently or they're currently watching that they really enjoy? It's a podcast that they're into. I try and get to learn about them through their interests, right? And I study those for at least a week, like looking at either whether it was note cards or now I use Google Forms because they all phones in different ways to input that. But I also then begin to make a playlist. And I say, hey, you can add to the playlist. We have our focus and study playlist. We have our build up energy. We have a wind down one. We have all kinds of different
Oh, purposes. I love that.
You can add to it. Now, for teachers out there, you got to think about, you know, I'm in a college classroom. Mm-hmm. I still have to think about, is it appropriate for everyone? And if there's a questionable song, you know, I say, hey, as a class, this is a song. I'm not here to censor. You're all grown, because they are. I said, you got to, this is part of the decision you got to make. But as an elementary school teacher and somewhat in high school, although I let them choose the older they got, you know, you got to do some FCC kind of censoring like Jess has to do when I send her the band propaganda. Because I did find a couple of songs that we can use because there's good message there. So yeah, we're preparing those things. We're getting to know. And I like the very first activity. I almost do this with all ages. I say, I want you to think of a place that matters so much to who you are, a place that has had a significant influence on who you are today, about the person that's in our room sitting here getting ready to learn together, and draw a picture of it. And all my classrooms, then it starts with crayons and pencils and all kinds of stuff. And I give out an extra large size paper, 11 by 14. Because we're going to make art to represent the places that matter to us. We do that. We share. We talk about it. Then we also, then the next day, have an activity where I say, okay, I want you to think of a person who has had a significant impact, a big influence on who you are today in this classroom. Like who you think of when I say, who's had a big influence on your life? Can it be anybody? Can be good influence, can be a bad influence. They just come to mind. And write on the back of that big piece of paper we drew about the places we love, the places that have influenced us the most. They write about the person who's influenced them the most. Okay? We share those. We celebrate it. We keep it. We get it going. The next time we do this activity, we do an activity warm up. Next class, like, hey, let's get into it. Let's stretch out. Let's warm up. Okay? Something, not a human and not a place, that has had a big influence on who you are. They say, what do you mean? I say, something that's not human and not a place. And they say, well, can it be a dog? Sure. Can it be a tree? Sure. I mean, technically that could be a place too, but you know what I mean? Like some species other than a human that we're remembering can be anything. They say, well, can it be a sport? Sure. Can it be anything, right? And they write about that. And then one of the things we do is we begin to share that we are learners together, but we are also carrying with us the best and the worst of who have influenced us, the places we come from, the things that have had a big impact on us. And so we are not only individuals, but we are collective as a community. And so we really talk about what that means to be part of a classroom in that way, that we are not only ourselves, but that ourselves is a unit of measurement that we're here for, right? But what does it mean to be here? And how are we always trying to be the very best of what's influenced us, even when some of those influences aren't always positive? So that's one of the little nuggets of the very first kinds of lessons I do.
That is so beautiful. And that just sets such wonderful groundwork for building that community and helping your students who are going to go on to be teachers to do that all important work of knowing themselves.
Well, and then I can connect the dots with those drawings and those writings. I can connect the dots to like the music they listen to. I got a good background and a base to which to get to know my students and to make connections to content. And for teachers out there, new teachers, we're always figuring this out early and it's a lot. But for veteran teachers, I know the math I'm teaching. I know the social studies. That's not me bragging, right? I just know the content. What I don't always know is the meaningful ways to connect it to the lives of my students and getting to know them and being patient about letting them have space and prompts to open up and share what they want. I'm not forcing it. We're letting it fly. Hey, lots of exciting stuff this week. Oh, big show tomorrow. Rethinking Schools educator Ty Marshall talking with us about transgender justice in schools. Huge topic. Awesome work. Can't wait for that. Join us. We got an exciting week. This is Busted Pencils. Stay tuned.